As the British people awaited today's publication of the much-anticipated Great Repeal Bill, this morning I posted my thoughts on Twitter, along with a link to a Wake the Feck Up podcast on the subject of Britain taking EU law up the aquis. Shortly afterwards, the proposed bill was published, and the contents clearly affirmed the scarcely understood points I made in the podcast regarding what can only reasonably be described as the Great British Brexit Swindle. Quoting directly from the bill, my tweets continued, EU-derived domestic legislation continues to have effect in domestic law on and after exit day. You can read the bill in full for yourself here, but suffice to say, that is not even the full extent of how the people have been duped into believing that Brexit would actually mean what the majority thought it meant last June. The formal cutting of legislative ties with the EU and the restoration of the supremacy of British common law. As I have also repeatedly stated, this result could be efficiently achieved by repealing the European Communities Act 1972, without which all EU statutes, directives and regulations would automatically become void, along with any claims as to the supremacy of EU law over British law. Whilst the repeal bill would repeal the 1972 Act, Section 5 makes provisions for the supremacy of UK law to be applied in relation to all enactments after exit day, but such supremacy will be subject to EU law every time the judiciary tries to interpret, disapply or quash any of the EU laws that would be adopted as UK laws on exit day, which would obviously not include the Charter of Fundamental Rights. 5. Exceptions to savings and incorporation. Subsection 1. The principle of the supremacy of EU law does not apply to any enactment or rule of law passed or made on or after exit day. Subsection 2. Accordingly, the principle of the supremacy of EU law continues to apply on or after exit day so far as relevant to the interpretation, disapplication or quashing of any enactment or rule of law passed or made before exit day. Subsection 3. Subsection 1 does not prevent the principle of the supremacy of EU law from applying to a modification made on or after exit day of any enactment or rule of law passed or made before exit day if the application of the principle is consistent with the intention of the modification. Subsection 4. The Charter of Fundamental Rights is not part of domestic law on or after exit day. In the event this bill is passed as drafted, the legal consequence of the Brexit referendum will be that neither the Brexiteers or the Remainers will get what they voted for, on the basis that Britain will have left the EU but will still be the vassal state of unaccountable bureaucrats in Brussels who will have a veto over every EU law adopted as UK law on exit day, whilst the courts would have legal authority to retain EU case law should it suit the establishment's purposes. This leaves the door wide open for the EU courts to overrule any British legal decision after the bill's enactment, on the basis that everything except the Charter will be retained, meaning that any and all changes to those laws will be subject to the scrutiny of the unelected EU commissars, including changes to existing financial obligations, immigration quotas, and any attempted abolition of the ruthless civil enforcement of political correctness, cultural Marxism, and the Kalergi Plan. The only realistic chance the bill has of being amended to any degree of meaning is if the government's parliamentary opposition, led by Labour's Red Jezza, unites and demands that the bill is redrafted to reflect the will of the majority who took part in the referendum, and many of those who didn't. As stated above, this could be done by simply repealing the 1972 Act, thereby nullifying the purported supremacy of EU laws upon these shores. The rest of every argument on either side of the entirely manufactured divide between Leave and Remain voters is merely orchestrated political window dressing, designed to hoodwink everybody into falsely believing that the government's puppet masters would ever determine political, social and cultural policy by a democratic plebiscite, which was, in truth, nothing more than the apparatus used to create the illusion of democratic freedom in order to divide and conquer the masses so that we are unable to organise any meaningful opposition to the tyrannies which successive governments perpetuate against us all. Until enough British voters wake up and realise that, whichever political candidate they vote for, the result is always predetermined by those who hold the government's purse strings, almost all of us will remain slaves to the banksters, and the Great British Brexit Swindle will continue, unabated by the public outrage, disobedience, and reform it truly warrants.